Well, in the blessed Holy Ghost, I'm Brother Dwayne, and welcome to another exciting episode of the Cry for America. We are brought to you by the Shekinah Family Worship Center, where Pastor Fields is our leader. We can be reached on the phone at area code 313-300-6457, or find us online under the Cry for America. We're on Facebook, Rumble, YouTube, and the Podbean Podcast. Please do us a favor and subscribe to our channel. Leave a like, a comment, a thumbs up. Share it across your social media platforms and help us to let this word of God go forth as we are documenting God's servant, Apostle Paul, as he is ministering here in Detroit, July 29th of 2023, ministering on the death life of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a life. Oh, what a death. Let's go now to Apostle Paul.
Sense. Yeah. We need to know those online. You think God cannot talk about you to us? You think God cannot talk about you to us? He can tell us. He been telling us about Julia, about Charlotte. Okay. Very soon we'll be talking about all of you. Yes. Woo! Yes, God. You see, that's the beauty of allowing the Holy Spirit to be real in our midst. Yes. That the Lord knows his own. Okay, and he's able to keep his own. Did you read Rich House? Did you read Rich House before? During the plague, okay, that plague that broke out, and the people, they said they ain't going to church, they ain't going to Rich House, you know, meeting. They don't want to serve his God, all right. And there was the flu that came among them, and they were dying. Okay, and the Lord told Rich House, nobody in the church will die. Are you hear that? He said, nobody under your care will die. Amen. Oh, yes, God. But did they come and confess that your God is stronger than our God? Didn't they come? Didn't those African, you know, whatever they call them, they came and said, we know that your God is stronger than our God. So we are coming to serve your God. He said, will your God receive you? He said, come on, he'll receive you. You see, God knows his people. We need ministers who are faithful to God, who have laid down their life down for God to live in them so he can reveal what is going on with the sheep. Yes. How is it that the sheep ain't doing well, but the pastor don't know? Right. The sheep are sickly, but the pastor don't know nothing. Oh my goodness. You must know your sheep. And God will let you know your sheep. Yeah. If you cry to him, he will tell you what's going on. You see that? So I said, wait upon the Lord for the fire. Make a commitment to wait for the Lord. For the Lord, we need the fire. You said, okay, your servant, your apostle said, you told them that we should wait. He said, that's what is left now. Wait for the fire to fall. He said, it will come. It has to permeate your being and put things right in your being. I said, wow. Fire. He said, don't you know fire put things right? It burns some stuff. It's like, you know, you go and get all your farm, you know, produce, and you spread it on the barn, and then you put fire in there to take away the, you know, all the, all the dross, all the things that are not right, okay? And then make everything dry good. You need to have fire in your being. So when you go, they know that you are walking in some realm that God alone can put you there. You think Jesus came down here, he was just playing church? Jesus was like a ball of fire in his being. My goodness. A ball of blazing fire in his being. Brethren, we shall walk in this fire. Maybe y'all don't want it. Maybe y'all online don't want that fire. But me, I want the fire. Amen. I want the fire. Without the fire, I'm nobody. Amen. It is the fire of the Holy Ghost that does the work of God. It's not the PhD, BBGY. Nowadays, ministers are running to go and get PhD degree. You crazy? Is that what Jesus came down with? PhD? Oh, yeah, I know. When Jesus came down, he had a lot of pack of degrees. So, go give to John Wesley this degree. Go give to O.R. Roberts this degree. Is that what he gave them?
Oh,
He gave them the same thing that we are asking for. Amen. Fire! Amen. Fire from on high. Jesus. I tell you. Me, I'm crazy tonight. You know I'm crazy. Yeah, I like it. I like my craziness. If you don't like it, me, I like it. I'm going to talk to you good tonight. I'm going to talk to you good tonight. I'm going to John G. Lake, but I'm going to tell you something that you have not seen. John G. Lake is an amazing guy. He's an amazing man, right? But you see, what I'm going to talk to you, all right? Okay, as I just saw in the Word, okay, as I'm thinking about what I'm going to read here, and I'm thinking, then I say, sir, don't you see this? Don't you see this? Don't you see this in the Word? So the Word of God is what we need to dwell richly in our being. Amen. And then bless Holy Ghost so the light can shine. Yes. It is the Holy Ghost who shines light on the Word. Right. You want understanding? Understanding comes from the Holy Ghost through the Word. Yes. You need wisdom? Come from the Holy Ghost through the Word of God. Yes. You need discernment? Comes from the Holy Ghost through the Word of God. The Holy Ghost and the Word. Amen. They work together to produce results. Oh, my Lord. Listen. All right. Me, I'll tell you something. What I'm going to tell you, you are either going to come in or you flee. Amen. You walking with me in the Holy Ghost? We are walking together with Jesus? You either coming in or you fleeing. Right. Come on in. And be counted for Jesus. Yes, stand for Jesus. And let Jesus be glorified in you. Yes. And then you have a big reward up there. Yes. All right? So that's what I'm looking for. I'm not crazy. You see, I know what God wants us to have. I know what God wants to do in our being. You're going to dry up the dry bones and put some fire in there. Yes. A living fire. A fire that has life. Yes. The fire that Moses went to see, he saw the fire is burning, but he ain't consuming the bush. The fire going to burn you not without consuming you. Yes. Ah, yes, God. My God. My God. Yes. Woo! All right, I'm going to read about the Leviticus 16, okay, and then talk to you about the two deaths. The two deaths that Jesus went through. I said, the two deaths that Jesus went through. Yeah. All right, you can cool down the French air now. Yeah. Cool down the French air. Later on, we'll have some French air. Yeah. Right now, all right. Hear this. The two deaths that Jesus faced, they are written down here. And I'm going to explain it to you. After the death of Aaron, Leviticus chapter 16. After the death of Aaron's two sons, when they drew near before the Lord, and before the Lord offered false fire and died, the Lord said to Moses, "Tell Aaron, your brother, he must not come at all times into the Holy of Holies within the veil before the mercy seat upon the ark, lest he die." Don't come there often. Don't linger there now. Okay? Don't linger here. Often, or you die. Wow, what a warning. Don't linger in my presence. You see, you all don't understand. Don't linger. It was a dangerous thing to linger in the presence of God during them days. Because the door to the Holy of Holies has not been opened. Because Christ had not come. So the high priest went there once a year. And if he's happy, if he's lucky, he comes out alive. If he ain't happy, he dies there. So God is telling him, don't come here, no, just like that, as if it is the place you frequent often. You don't frequent in my presence often. Don't come here all the time. Lest you die. Wow, what a difference nowadays. You see the difference? I say, you see the difference? What is the difference between yesterday and today? Yesterday, you dare not go there. Today, if you don't go there, you die.
That's right.
See the difference? Yesterday, Aaron was warned, don't come here often. If you come here often, kaput. You die. I don't want you coming in my presence like that. Once a year is enough for you and the whole nation. Wow! You don't see God but once a year. But thank God, I will make a new covenant. Yeah. Not like the covenant which I made with your fathers when I took their hands and brought them out of Egypt. That covenant they did not obey. They didn't keep it. And therefore, I didn't regard them. But the days are coming when I'll do a new covenant with you, the house of Israel. Ah, he said, that covenant, brother, I'll write my laws in your being.
Yes, God.
And then what else? You can come before me.
Come on.
You can come before me now in the new covenant.
Yes, God.
Because why? Because Christ came and brought the new covenant. And when he paid the price, those long curtains that separated the human being from the presence of God was ripped apart. And now God came out. Wow. Jesus, wow, you've done a good job. Wow, I didn't see that. I didn't see this place. Wow, this place. Now my people can come before me. Yeah, daddy, I tore it open. I tore that separation veil. So now my people can call, yeah, daddy, they are coming. They are coming in my name. You say, nah, I'm going to tell you that I'm going to pray for you. Because my father, daddy loves you.
Yeah.
So you go in there, in my name, go there.
Amen.
If you don't go there, you die. You hear the difference?
That's right.
If you don't go into the presence of God nowadays, you can't make it.
That's right. Amen.
If you don't go into the presence of the living God nowadays, you can't make it. The New Testament gave us access. Access to the very presence of the living God.
Amen.
That is the mighty grace that was given to us. Grace, God's marvelous grace. God justified us. He said, I see you. I give you the righteousness of my son because you believed on him. So you are righteous. So I give you a righteous standing. Come on in. Come on in any hour you want. I can come. Wow. But Aaron, you are, watch out, Aaron, watch out. Don't come here now. Don't come here quite often. You die.
Wow. Jesus.
What a difference.
Yeah.
You see that?
Mm-hmm.
What a grace. What a marvel that the human being can now go before the very presence of the living God and he don't die because now he has hidden him in Christ.
Amen.
The Lord has put us into Christ. Our life is hidden in Christ, okay, in God. So now we go in there, Christ covers us. We are covered with the blood. We are covered with the life of the very God who says, now come on into my presence. Come and let us commune. I'll come. Hold on, Jesus. The work that you did is such a good work. Yeah, daddy, yeah. So why? Now daddy can come and live in them. Now daddy can come and live in the in his sons. Wow! He that has my commandments and what obeys it, like what? He's the one that loves me. And he that loves me, my father will love him. And I will love him. I will first reveal myself to him. And then my father and I will come and I'll make our abode.
Yeah.
Abode. I didn't say abode though. I say abode. he said, come on in. Jesus, let's go. Yeah, let's go and dwell. That's the new dwelling place that your blood has prepared for us. What a difference between the old and then the new.
Right.
Oh God, we must thank this God. We must be thanking him all the time. Because you see, he's not far. Listen, listen, what is that? Sister, I've asked Sister Julia to send to all of you, okay, a message in 2014 in Edmonton. Send to all of you. What I'm talking about, okay, was said, you know, during that time. I had said, I said, now hold on. You mean these are the words that they were hearing? Whoa! And the minister did not, you know, take it seriously, and now they are all dead? Quite untensania. The word of God, the mystery. Oh, go and God. I say, Sister Julia should send it to everybody. All those online. Listen to it. Okay? Listen to it. Because it's a marvelous word. It's an amazing word, okay? There are two words. If you want, ask for the first one too. Because you need to listen to that. Preparing yourself, all right, for your old age. Ah, yes, God. You all think you'll not be old? You all think you ain't going to be old? You grow old. But you can be young while you are growing old. You can be younger in spirit while you are growing old in age. Human age makes you say you're old. Oh, but God, don't deal with old. Deal with the young. And we are young in the spirit, okay? All right, so he told Aaron, don't come here quite often. Wow, don't enter the Holy of Holies where there is life because I'm there, all right? But don't come there quite often. Wow, why would God do that? Because Christ hadn't come. The price has not been paid. Sin is what is barring them from the very presence of God. So sin must first be dealt with before we can be allowed to come to the very presence of God. And thank God that's what Jesus did.
Amen.
And I'm going to tell you that Jesus died twice. Jesus died twice. We've lost sight of we only remember the cross death. When he hung on the cross, that's the only death that we remember. Quite an time, Sanya, it's in the Bible. And we don't look at it. And you are not looking, because you don't know that death, you have refused to die.
Jesus.
Because nobody talked about that second death. I think it was even the first death before the death on the cross. Okay? Because we have not been taught about this. All right? The death life until finally, okay, hanging on the cross.
Amen.
Okay? Because we don't know it, okay, we refuse to obey God. We kick against God. The circumstances God allows in our life to bring about death or no. We kick and we bolt. Oh, you know the harness of the horse? You see, some of you are like the fresh horse. He bolted. He jumped the high fence. He said, me? I'm gone. I know. This death, I ain't going to die. I want my freedom. The freedom, free freedom. What happened to his freedom? About 3 years later, what happened to him? Ah, brother, he looks so sad, so sad. Lean and lanky and almost dead. Lean, lanky, and dying. All right? So the harness of the horse, go and read that. Because that's your life. Okay? The first death. Okay, we'll read about it. Let's go. It said here. He said, tell Aaron, your brother, he must not come at all times into the Holy of Holies within the veil. Verse 2. Within the veil before the mercy seat upon the ark, lest he die. For I will appear in the cloud on the mercy seat. So don't come and, you know, stick your neck in there. You cannot take your neck out. They will have to drag you. You know the what the high priest, his robe, he has some bells. some belt out there, and some long rope that when he goes in, the rope is outside. When he's in entering the Holy of Holies, the rope is there hanging on the outside where the people are meeting. Because he may die. And nobody can go in there, go and bring him out. So when the bell ain't ringing, then they go, whoa. What, my God, brother. We must thank God. We must really thank God. Amen. What kind of service is this? Mm-hmm. Whoa!
Amen.
<My
goodness>.
All right, let's go. He says, don't let him come in there because he will die. But Aaron shall come into the holy enclosure in this way, with a young bull for a sin offering, and a ram for a burnt offering. He shall put on the holy linen undergarment, and he shall have the linen breeches upon his body, and be girded with a linen girdle or sash, and with a linen turban or mitre shall he be attired. These are the holy garments. He shall bathe his body. This is exactly what the baptism is so far in the Old Testament. The bathing, the washing of the priest. The washing. They had to wash Aaron. They had to wash Aaron and his children. Right? Before they could begin their ministry. Okay? But this washing is now substituted by the baptism. Okay, the baptism. Okay, that's what it says. So they said Aaron must be washed with bathe his body in water, and then he can put on the garments.
That's right.
Yeah. You ain't bathe, you ain't putting on no garments for ministry.
Yeah.
So Jesus had to be baptized because he's a priest. That's the form of the baptism that was introduced in the new covenant. But in the old covenant, the priest was washed. He was washed before he put on his garments. Right? Jesus, with the coming of John the Baptist, a new era began. John began with the baptism that God sent him to do. God told him what to come and do. Right? So that's it. And then he said here, he shall take at the expense of the congregation of the Israelites two male goats for a sin offering, and one ram for a burnt offering. And Aaron shall present the bull as a sin offering for himself, and make atonement for himself and for his house, the other priests. He shall take the two goats and present them before the Lord at the door of the tent of meeting. Aaron shall cast lots, listen carefully, lots on the two goats, one lot for the Lord, and the other lot for Azazel, or remover. The other goat is going to fulfill this function called the remover of sin. A goat that is going to remove sin. What are they going to do? He's not going to be killed. He's not going to be killed. He's going to die naturally. Azoo. Oh, those who are slow to understanding. I'm dealing with those who are slow to understanding. Ain't that something? How can I say that the Lord called me that? Well, he calls me, then I call you too. So we are slow to understand. When he explains, oh yeah, now we see. So you two, you'll be slow to understand, then I'll explain. Oh yeah, yeah, now I see. Lord have mercy upon us. It's just amazing. I thank God. Listen, I thank God. I don't know how God took us. I don't know how I came. I was an atheist. I drink about no God. All right. The French philosophers were my God, and that's it. I didn't care. And on the point of suicide, if I was God and I saw you say you don't believe on me, and now you are dying, I'll come and stand behind you on that cliff and push you down. See, that's what I would do. That's what I would do if I was God. And you say you are atheist, you don't want to believe on me, I'll come and push you down then when you are about to commit suicide. I make it double suicide. But God didn't do that. My God, he spared my life. God, brother, listen. You see, there are times I think like Paul thinks. Brother, this guy spared me. Oh, no, I must go all out for him. I must go. I don't deserve it. What am I going to do to deserve nothing? I must go all out for my God who spared me. He spared me, brother. I didn't know that I was going to hell. I thought I was serving God, said Paul. That is the reason why Paul went all out. Because he saw it. He didn't deserve what was happening to him. He realized, wow, this is grace. This is grace for me. I killed his children. Oh, no. I persecuted his church. I blasphemed against his holy name. And he spared me. He gave me grace. Whoa, no. For the rest of my life. That, you see, it all happens. He said, listen, did you not see Paul said, listen, I don't care about your offering. I'm going to work. Do you see that? Because he said, no. If this guy spared me, I'm not going to do anything to put a stumbling block in the way of the gospel. Come on, brother. Even though I have the right not to work as a man of God, I have the right, because he said, they that preach the gospel must live of the gospel. I, Paul, oh no, I can't do that. I'll forgo all those rights. It is not obligatory. Okay? He wasn't forced. He said, no. I have the right to do that. Because God said, this is how you live, by the gospel. Amen. He said, okay, God, I know. But oh no, I don't want to do nothing to hinder. So if I can work, I'll go work. Okay, he didn't work all the time. There are times he shut down his business for about 3 months. No, nobody told him, hey, go back to work. All right? He shut down his business. All right? Because, listen, when you serve God and you are working full time too, brother, it ain't fun. It ain't fun. And if you allow God, if you trusted God, God could say, son, I can take care of you. I can take care of you. Did he not tell Rich House? Rich House? Listen, why not come and work for me? You're working for another master. And you spend 8 hours with another master. Why not come and give me all the hours that you spend it to somebody? Come. He said, but Lord, I'm serving you. I'm doing your way. So no, this guy is paying you for the work you're doing. Just come. I'll take care of you. And Rich House came and lived by faith and trusted God. Did God not take care of him? Yes. In the end, Rich House was responsible for thousands of pounds, all right, in his hands for taking care of orphans, taking care of buildings that God led him to buy for God. Amen. Okay, to buy real estate for God, for the school that God wanted to build. Those schools, the school is still there, in London. I've asked Pastor Lena Kwanza, don't come back to America until you have gone to that school. Go find it out and then call me. I'll talk to somebody there. Thank you. So I've told him, listen, because he's in London now, doing some course. I said, don't come back unless you go to Swansea and go to Rich House Bible College. Okay, it's there. It's still there. Rich House Bible College, and call me so I can talk to somebody there that I would like to come and teach there. Oh, teach Rich House. Oh, brother. Ain't that something? But brother, here, God has ordained. Right? But Paul says, it will be part of my sacrifice that I want to give to the gospel. When I can work, okay, I will work so that what they could give me as a support, they can use to bless the poor. That is Paul's mindset. Okay, but there are times He didn't work. Okay, he was traveling all the time. And so the churches had to send him offering. Don't forget, those that preach the gospel shall live by the gospel. Amen. That is what God has ordained. You see that? And so don't think that God will neglect you if you came to serve him full time. Okay? He must have to train you in faith. Train you in trusting him. Trust and confiding in his great love. From all harm, you'll be safe. Okay? So God has to train you. I want to tell you something. Anyone who wants to serve God, you have to pass through the hands of God. I don't care what your pastor does for you. I don't care what your denomination sends you and go to Bible school, BBZY. It's not BBZY. It's passing through the hand of the Creator, Redeemer, God. You sit at his feet and he will talk to you. All right? He will talk to you. He will train you. He will raise you up. He will tune you up. He will work deep in your being and establish your confidence in him. He will cut off the links that bind your soul to the world and to your old friends. He will cut it off. And then listen. When he cuts it off, all the links you had with your parents, your this, your that, your all, that will be cut off. All right? And draw you to himself. Notice what I'm telling you. Draw you to himself. Bind your soul to his soul. Bind your heart to himself. Bind your spirit to his. All right? So that you receive everything from him. You get to know him intimately well. That's why he cuts off all your friends, everything that you used to have in the world. It's all gone. He cuts it off. Because the first thing God wants to establish in your life, if you want to walk with him, that you have to look to him. You have to look to him. Him and him alone. You don't go and look to God and look to your mama. You don't look to God and look to your daddy. Okay? You look to God until you know that everything that you will need, God will supply.
Yes,
God. You hear that? You want to serve God, he's not going to let you have two sets of eyes. You look at God and you look at the devil. You look at the world and you go, oh, God. Oh, no, it can't be so. Focus on the Lord Jesus Christ. Until you get to know his heart. Because what you are taking back to the people when he begins to send you is what you have learned from him.
Amen.
What you have learned from the intimate presence that the Lord poured into your being. That is what you take out there. You don't take some theology. You don't take some. You take what you receive from Christ. In those maybe 3 or 4 or 5 years, it has been 7 years, you know, with us, walking with him. Okay? 7 years, we ain't even going, reach nowhere. But he's taught us a lot. Okay? We've come to see a lot of our God and what he demands. When you are walking with him, what you must be careful about. He don't like double do. Or double do. All right, don't look here and look here. Don't look here. Don't serve two masters.
Amen.
You can't serve God and serve mammon. You can't serve God and serve the devil. All right, there's only one God.
Amen.
That you have to serve. Okay, that manifests himself in three persons.
Yes.
You have to be close to them, to be part of their life. They will be part of your life.
Yes, God.
Oh my goodness. Oh, the triune God will be part of your life. And so you'll be walking in a privileged in the company. You'll be walking in a privilege with a privileged company. The triune God. You are a servant of the triune God.
Amen.
You live unto them. You are their servant. You are their vessel. You are the one they have chosen to train so they can flow through you and send you wherever they need you to go.
Amen.
This is the ministry. Okay? The ministry is not activity. It's a life lived with God, through which God preparing you, okay, establishing you, dealing with you, okay, disciplining you, and then releasing life into your being. So you can take life wherever you go. You can take life, and wherever you go, they don't leave you alone. Oh no, they don't let you go alone. Anywhere you are going, they give you the permission to go there. Because you belong to them. See, that is, see, why I'm saying that, because that is death. So you have not understood that there is a dying when we come to God. There is a dying through obedience. A dying to the self life. A dying to everything that is natural about you. You die to sin. You die to your will, to your desires, your everything must go. That is the first death that this goat here we're going to read about. That is what happens to this goat, this Azazel, that Jesus fulfilled this type. Okay, let me read it to you. It says here, he shall take, verse 7, he shall take the two goats and present them before the Lord. At the door of the tent of meeting, Aaron shall cast lots on the two goats. One lot for the Lord, the other lot for Azazel, or removal. All right, that will explain some more. And Aaron shall bring the goat on which the Lord's lot fell and offer him as a sin offering. Right? As a sin offering. The first goat will be the sin offering. But the goat, the sin offering, okay, they will burn it. Okay, after they find it, the blood will be sprinkled, and then they will burn that sin offering, that goat, that fresh one. Okay, and then he says here, and Aaron shall bring the goat on which the Lord's lot fell and offer him as a sin offering. But the goat on which the lot fell for Azazel or removal shall be presented alive before the Lord. Notice, presented alive before the Lord to make atonement over him, that he may be let go into the wilderness for Azazel for dismissal. Okay, that's what, let's go on. Let me read some more. It says here, come to the, let me see. Okay, I want to continue from here. Okay, all right, go to verse 15. Then shall he kill the goat of the sin offering. Remember, the sin offering, the one that's going to be offered unto the Lord for the people. The sin offering, that is for the people, and bring his blood within the veil, and do with the blood as he said, and as he did with the blood of the bullock. The bullock was for Aaron and his family. Okay? And the blood of the goat here, all right, is for the people. The atonement for the people. Okay? All right? So, and sprinkle upon the mercy seat and before the mercy seat. And he shall make an atonement for the holy place because of the uncleanness of the children of Israel and because of their transgressions in all their sins. And so shall he do for the tabernacle of the congregation that remaineth among them in the midst of their uncleanness. And there shall be no man in the tabernacle of the congregation when he goeth in to make an atonement in the holy place until he come out and have made an atonement for himself and for his household and for all the congregation of Israel. And he shall go out unto the altar that is before the Lord and make an atonement for it. And he shall take the blood of the bullock and of the blood of the goat and put it upon the horn of the altar round about. And he shall sprinkle of the blood upon it with his finger seven times and cleanse it and hallow it from the uncleanness of the children of Israel. And when he has made an end of reconciling the holy place and the tabernacle of the congregation and the altar, he shall bring the live goat, the Azazel. Notice. And Aaron shall lay both his hands upon the head of the live goat, the Azazel, the one that's going to go away, carrying their sins into the wilderness. And he's going to die there. Right here. The live goat. And confess over him all the iniquities of the children of Israel. And all their transgressions. In all their sins. Putting them upon the head of the goat. The Azazel. And shall send him away. Send this goat. They don't kill this goat. He ain't killed. His blood is not spilled. But they lead him by the hands of a Levite. Okay, it's a man that is strong. But you see, it's the Levite that will lead them, because they are the one that handled the goat. All the sacrificial offerings by the priest. Okay, and the Levite. Alright, so I say here, and putting them upon the head of the goat, and shall send him away by the hand of a fit man into the wilderness. A fit man. look at the Amplified. And verse 21. And Aaron shall lay both his hands upon the head of the live goat, and confess over him all the iniquities of the Israelites, and all their transgressions, all their sins. And he shall put them upon the head of the goat, the sin bearer. Hai Gandara Muzagas. Christ our sin bearer. Christ our sin bearer, and send him away into the wilderness by the hand of a man who is timely, ready, and fit. Listen, the goat shall bear upon him all their iniquities, carrying them to a land cut off. Azuma Gazas. A land that is cut off, a land of forgetfulness and separation, not inhabited. And the man leading the goat shall let the goat go in the wilderness. He will roam around there until everything natural about this goat dies. This goat dies a natural death. Nobody killed it. By roaming around in the wilderness. Listen, he said he will go for 3 days journey into the wilderness. Now I want to bring your attention to the 3 years of the ministry of Jesus Christ in the wilderness of this life. This God-forsaken, God-forgotten, you know, place called Earth, where sin abounds. Okay, and Jesus came and walked in the midst of this land, all right, surrendering everything about him as he obeyed. You got to understand, okay? Now, let me read something. To him to whom you yield yourself servant to obey, you are the servant of the one to whom you obey. Whether unto righteousness or whether unto sin, you are the servant of righteousness or the servant of sin. All right? And Christ came as a servant, okay, of God who yielded himself to obey God. So every area of the 3.5, listen to this. So all we know is the cross death. How finally he hung on the cross. But he couldn't go to the cross without having been the Azazel goat first. And the Azazel goat, in a comparison, because he fulfilled that. He's the sin bearer into the wilderness. He took our sin into the wilderness, okay, as the goat did. The goat carried the sin. He was not killed, but he died naturally from obedience. The goat died because he was just obeying what he was sent out there to do. Christ died to everything natural about him. He died to sin so that sin could not touch him. He died to everything natural, his will. He died to every desire. He died to everything that concerns the life of man. He died to it completely. Okay? His will was completely yielded. The obedience of that 3 years obedience, you tried. Try without sin. Okay, for three years living complete and total obedience to God in the land where snares and every kind of provocation, all right, is brought in your place. The Sadducees try to entrap you. The Pharisees trying to ensnare you. The devil also is trying to ensnare you. And yet you have come to do only one thing, the will of God,
yes, God.
Not the will of man. Okay? Now, let me ask you. If you are not aware, listen to it today. The Bible says, by the disobedience of one man. By what? The disobedience of one man. Many were made what?
Sinners.
Okay? And by the what? By the obedience. Obedience of one man. Half obedience or total obedience?
Absolute.
It is by his obedience, and obedience, you know, entailed surrendering every part of his triune being as a man, spirit, soul, and body. Completely surrendered to God. Completely not doing his will. You will understand, John, why Jesus said, I came here not to do my will. No, I haven't come to violate anything that my Father didn't tell me to do. I ain't gonna do it. I must be a lamb without spot nor wrinkle. Complete and total obedience is what I suffered. I died to my will. I died to my own desire. I died to wanting to have my own way. I died because I obeyed. And you all do understand that when you are obeying, you are dying. Obedience is dying. That's what it is.
Amen.
That's why, you see, I told you, God calling. God calling. You're the one I read out. God calling. Brother Dwayne looking at me like, hey, what are you talking about? God called. He says, you don't understand that it is by my obedience that I save you.
That's right.
It's by my obedience that I save.
Yes.
If he did not obey, he couldn't save. Because the people he's coming to save, they are sinner men. They are disobedient people. And he's come to represent them before God. He must not be like them. The devil knew it. That's why he was trying to, you know, tempt him. He wanted to trip him. So he'll have a little sense. No, he ain't perfect. Well, God, it is no perfect lamb. You hear that? Jesus was aware of the implications of a little disobedience. That will disqualify him from being our Savior. So what is it? The humility of Jesus is his perfect obedience.
Amen.
That's it. His humility and his obedience, they go together.
That's right.
What makes a man not obey God? It's not easy to obey God. I say it's not easy to obey God. Okay, you have to humble yourself.
Amen.
Humble yourself before God. If you don't humble yourself before God, you cannot represent him. Because he's a humble God.
Amen.
He's a humble God.
Amen.
He obeys.
Yes.
But the last time when the Lord talked to us about my Father loves me. My Father loves me because I keep His commandments, mm-hmm. and I do always those things that please Him. Mm-hmm. He says, "Listen, that thing got to my soul. Here is the Savior. He's telling you how He walked, mm-hmm. and saying, I did not cause any trouble for my Father. I did not cause any problems. A man causes problem. You guys, you don't understand. Man is the most rebellious creature
mm-hmm.
in the face of the earth. Because we gave him a free will. The free will has been, has become his downfall. Well, he didn't know how to use the free will. Free will is given to you for one reason only, to exercise, to choose what is good. And what is good is God.
Amen.
What is good is God. That's the only thing that is good. God alone is good. So free will to choose, because if God cannot force you, He can't force Himself on you. So He has to find a way, okay, to allow you to express your choice. Okay, I lay before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Choose life. He didn't tell you choose death. Choose life and you will live, you and your children. All right, but man or no? Man he's a troublemaker. And the Lord said, all I did, oh my Lord, he said, I was just quiet. But have you not read in Matthew's gospel that it is written, my beloved, he said, nobody will hear his voice in the street. Nobody will see him quarreling or doing anything of the sort until he has brought righteousness, Lord, into victory. You see that? He said, I walk quietly.
Yes.
Quietly before my Father. I did not do anything that my Father told me not to do. I just obeyed my Father. I just obeyed. He said, I was quiet. Quiet. By the way, he said, Kong. In our language, boy, he went to my soul. He said, Kong. He says, it's like silently and quietly I walked. Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
Well, but you and I, what do? We don't. We no. Kick against everybody. All right. So here, obedience is what the first thing that Jesus established, what his utter and total surrender to God's will before the cross, and that obedience led him to die. As he obeyed, he was dying to self. He came as a man. He had a self life that he did not express. The self life, he will not express. That's why he said, I came here not to do my will. I came to do the will of him that sent me. I must obey. Obedience, you have not, you watch it. As you are yielding to God, you are dying. I guess you are not. Obedience is the way God established for man to die to his will.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
To die to his own plans. To die to his expression of his own. He said, freedom of speech. Ain't no freedom of speech, with God. Are you hearing me now? He don't exist. Ain't no speech. The only speech you speak is what glorifies God. You can't say your mind. You say your mind and you go contrary to God. So you have to watch what you say when you walk with God.
Amen.
You have to be very careful. Because he ain't giving you the authority and power to do what you want. Especially when he's chosen you to be his vessel. Look at, you don't remember Moses? Moses. they provoked Mo. Brother, he had enough. For Mo to yield to them and talk some stuff that he should not have talked. One time he said some stuff that God did not approve. That's it, Mo. That's it. You did not honor me. But Lord, these are rebels. They've been rebelling all the time. They're me, I love them. Oh no, you know better. You ought to have glorified me, sanctified my name in the presence of the rebels. You got to have shown that when you are dealing with God, you obey all the time. You didn't do that. So now you are part of their problem now. Now you are like them. Now you give them the ability to keep on, you know, rebel. I have to deal with you. Because they have to know that I don't tolerate rebellion even for my servant. Whoa! My goodness. Jesus. Are you hearing me now? Amen. You don't know how merciful God has been to us. Yes. He's been very merciful. He's been very merciful. Merciful and gracious. Mm-hmm. All right? That he expects you to obey him.
That's right. Come on.
Mm-hmm. Because he knows the only way you can die to his satisfaction is by complete and utter obedience to him. Ain't no cross here. Okay? The cross is what men chose to hang him on there to fulfill the curse of the law. Okay? The law said, you know, curse is the man that is hung on the tree. So they wanted to show this man is a cursed man. So that's what they put him on the tree. Okay? Because they thought this man is not of God. He's not of God. Now what he said, no, he was blaspheming against God. So they thought he was what? Cursed. Yeah, they thought he was a criminal. That's why they hang him on the cross. But the real death that he went through was to demonstrate the complete and utter obedient life that God expected from man. For man will not do his will. Man will not go contrary to God's will. Man will always choose God's will. Amen. Even if when he's doing that, he's dying.
That's right.
He's dying. We are dying to self, dying to our own desires, dying to our own thinking.
That's right.
Ah, boy, you can think some stuff that God knows what you're thinking ain't right. But you're thinking it because you think you can think it. Because you think you can think it, then you think a free thought. Brother, you don't work like that. All right? He says here, what's his name? Thou shalt keep him what? In perfect peace. Whose mind is roaming around?
No, stayed on him.
His mind is stayed on him. Because what? Because he trusted in him. All right? So the death that Jesus, the first death over here, that for Jesus was the 3 years ministry in which he did not do his will. He was dying. He was taking it, especially when he came to the Garden of Gethsemane, when he knew death was coming. You see, he knew death was coming because they said, listen, when somebody sweats blood like that, like the drops of blood coming out from him because of the intense agony of his soul, he's near dying. He's very close to dying. And he knew that he must not die in the garden. He has to die on the cross. He has to die. That's why I said, Father, if it be thy will, let this cup pass. Because it's not here that we agree that I should die. We didn't agree that I'll come and die here in this garden. Father, it is in Jerusalem I should go and hang on the cross. So Lord, didn't you hear that I said when he prayed, okay, that thy will be done, not my will, but thy will, that angels were sent him to strengthen him? Because he was in a tottering towards death. It was overwhelming. And yet, he wasn't ready to die. He wanted to die where it was ordained for him to die, in Jerusalem. He and his father agreed that they will nail you to the cross. So after perfect obedience, now he's going now to hang over there and take our sins and nail it on the cross. Are you seeing the two? That let me read this to you, because you haven't. Go to Philippians. Something interesting that I saw in the book of Philippians. Okay, the book of Philippians. All right, look at it. All right. Let this mind. Okay, you know that. All right, two. Let this mind, or this attitude, this same attitude, this mind and purpose and humble mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. Let that be in you. Let him be your example in humility, who, although being essentially one with God and in the form of God, possessing the fullness of the attributes which make God God. Wow, I like that. Okay? Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. I like it. He possesses all the attributes of God which make God God. Did not think this equality with God was a thing to be eagerly grasped or retained, but stripped himself of all privileges and rightful dignity, so as to assume the guise of a servant slave, in that he became like man and was born a human being. And after he had appeared in human form, he abased and humbled himself still further and carried. I know that it didn't strike you. It hasn't struck me before until this evening I entered here, because I've been talking. I was talking to the Lord. Lord, what is it? I want to go to the two goats, but you know what do you want to show me? And I have not seen this before. I have not read it the way the Lord opened it up to me. And he abased and humbled himself still further, and carried his obedience. His what?
Obedience.
He carried his obedience to the extreme of death. One death. Death is one death.
Amen.
Even the death of the cross.
Yes. Amen.
Two. He carried his obedience to death, to the extreme of death, even to as far even, not just to death, but as far even to the cross. So the one death was for the Azazel goat, where his will, all right, his powers and everything that he has, as when he appeared as a man, he had to surrender all. Surrender all to obey the Father. His obedience going to, listen, why did he tell John the Baptist, hey, listen, I know what you're talking about. Yeah, I know you want me to baptize you, but brother, that's not it. I've come to do my Father's will. You are the one that the Father established before. You are the one that we prepared you before. So you are to precede me and come and do this. So you suffer it. That's so to be, for thus we shall fulfill all righteousness. I must submit to you. I don't care what you say. I must submit to you. I created you, but I must. This one, that's your job now. You call the shots. I will obey. You think it's easy to come and surrender, okay, your life to somebody that your Father created? You planned that, you know, to come and lead you, prepare the path for you. You must honor him. Give honor to whom? I say, the Lord is strong upon this principle. Give honor to whom honor is due. Don't forget that. The Lord is very strong, very, very strong on that. Give honor even unto Caesar. What belongs to Caesar, give to him. What the honor that belongs to an elderly person, give a tanga sibraka. Give that to them. The honor that belongs to a little child, give them the honor. Respect. Respect authority. Here, it is here in America that authorities are not respected. In America, that's one thing that is so amazing. You want God, but you don't teach your children to respect authority. No. Ain't right. Give honor to whom honor is due. All right? The Lord is very strong. All right? So, he said here, he humbled himself and died. Not even the death of the cross too. This is how he came to me this morning. I said, whoa, because I'm looking for the Azazel. And then we're going to look at, you know, John G. Lake, you know, how he also saw it. It's amazing that by his extreme obedience, okay, he died willingly. This is the life death that John G. Lake, you know, talks about. He's living by his dying. He's living by his dying. Dying to selves, dying to sin, dying to everything. He will not allow sin to touch him. Dying to his will, dying to his own ideas about the ministry. Oh yeah, we got plenty about ministry. Everybody got the Lord. So that's what the Lord said. Hey, it's over. The way men have done ministry is over now. Nobody gets up anymore and say, I'm going to do a church for God. He said, it's over. I don't recognize those things because I have to send you before you can go and do my church work.
Amen.
I don't send you. You go. I don't regard what you did. You didn't serve me. Are you hearing me? You go to Bible school. You go and get some little, myself, I'm going to serve God. I'm going to do some church. You go and mess everything up. And it becomes a mess. And that's why we got all kinds of stuff, all kinds of teaching. My goodness, all kinds of my law. Did God send them and they don't see the word of God? Where would that? Listen. We said the gospel was first preached by the Lord Jesus Christ, right? Okay? When accompanied by signs and wonders, right? And it was confirmed to us by those who were eyewitnesses, his apostles. They also preached the same thing, and the Father testified to the preaching of the apostles with signs and wonders and miracles. You hear that? The Father confirmed the preaching of the apostles. Read Hebrews chapter 2. You see that? And you think this order, you know, is over? This order has not been obliterated. It has not been changed. Jesus still is confirming the true apostles. He's confirming the true prophets that he appointed. He's sending evangelists and pastors and teachers that he has raised up. And he confirms their meetings. He confirms what they say in his name. All right, mama, give me some little bottle of water. Ooh, yes, God. Thank you, Jesus. Brethren, I'm talking to you.
Amen.
Okay, brethren, we are studying the word of God.
Amen.
Thank you. What time is it? All right. In the next 15 minutes, I'll finish. All right. So I just brought this. He said he died, even the death of the cross. Right? So in this sentence, we have the dying to the self-life. It was because Christ died to the self-life that he could die on the cross. Oh, okay? Because if his will was still alive, he couldn't go there. But for 3 years, as the Azazel goat, carrying the sins of the people, and walking and throwing it out, killing and dying and dying and dying and dying until the will was completely yielded. In the Garden of Gethsemane, the end came. Father, if it is your will that this is the place I'm going to end, your will be done. And yet, it's not my will, but your will. Okay, we agreed that it is Jerusalem I must go and die on the cross, openly exposed to the ridicule of them devils. All right, so Father, okay, now what happened? They sent what angels to strengthen him. And from there, he was ready. From the Garden of Gethsemane, he was ready. Judas them came. They brought all the police to come and arrest him. He was ready. He knew it was ready. He was ready. He wouldn't resist them. He wouldn't do anything. Oh, my God. Can you be that obedient? Can you be that obedient, standing before Pilate? And you created him now, and he talking some stuff to you. Look at some guys say, hey, when Jesus said, listen, he said, are you the king of the Jews? You have said it. He said, and then the guy said, hey, don't you know that that's the high priest, and you talking like that? So he said, listen, if I have done something wrong, tell me what I did. But if I ain't done nothing wrong, you ain't got no right to to do what you've done, right? But the guy was just rebuking him. Mm-hmm. And then Pilate asked him several questions. He said, he answered not a word. Go and read about it in God calling. He says, you all don't understand, but my silence, was the display of the complete and utter surrender of my body, of my will, and everything was yielded, complete control. The spirit had the complete control over my body. Dead to all that they are going to do to him. Brother, if it was your blood will be boiling hot. If it was any of your blood, boy, oh boy, amen. I'm looking at you. You will see if I get you. But Peter said when he was reviled, he reviled not back. When he was tortured, he said he did not, he did not know, that's a word. He didn't threaten nothing. He didn't threaten vengeance. Boy, I will threaten some. You wait. Hey, if I get you, he said, oh yes, sir, what are you talking about? No. You see what I'll do to you? He didn't do that. Christ didn't do that. He didn't threaten nobody. But me, I will do. I know you're going to kill me. All right, kill me. But I'll save my one piece of mind. Oh. You see that? Oh, yeah. Yes, God. Well, no, I don't want no obedience, brother. I'll do you some. All right, let's go. He says here. Let's go to John G. Lake's book, page 580. The type. Okay, he says here, the type. In going into this question of the death life, my spirit recently has been drawn out to observe that in the Old Testament there is a type and evidence of the real death life. In the 16th chapter of Leviticus, we have that wonderful picture of the atonement and life-death of the Lord. Life-death, the two combination of the Lord. Likewise, the atonement and life-death of his people. What he went through is what we are going to go through. Yeah. Okay? That's why I said complete obedience leads you to die. obedience, the very word of obeying. You obeying somebody. You are yielding your will to do what he's telling you. What is happening to your will? Your will is dying. What happened to your thoughts that you want to tell him? You can't tell him. What became your choice you want to choose? You can't choose nothing. Complete and utter obedience deprives you of your own personal expressions. You can't. You are under command to obey. And when you obey, you cannot express anything else except do what you are told. That is dying. In the spirit, we call it dying to self, dying to your will, dying to your desires, dying to your choices, dying to everything. Oh, hey, Lord, I saw a woman here. I would like to marry her. I love her. So that's what I want. Son, but you didn't ask me. Oh, no, I didn't need to. I didn't need to ask you. I love her. Son, look at what happened to our brother that we were praying for, all right? And the Lord, I have that message. I'm keeping that message until the Lord tells me. Okay? Here the Lord has said, the woman you want to marry, her feet are dirty in the spirit. Okay, so don't. If you marry her, you have trouble. You have trouble. And so now the Lord said, I have somebody I'm preparing for you. So you wait. Say, tell him to wait. Okay, I have the message there. I read the message to him. Now he comes, he said, no, God told me the woman that I said I'm gonna marry, that's the one I'm gonna marry. Here he marries her. Is that an obedient child? No. You see, we have our will, brother. Amen. He crossed God. So what is gonna happen? That's not the perfect line. Brethren, watch against that. Okay, let God choose for you. When God finally chose for me, look at the joy I've had with this woman. Oh, yes, God. Yeah. I mean. That's true. It's right. The price is right, brother. Woo! I got just what the doctor described, not prescribed for me. Dr. Jesus prescribed this for me. I'm telling you, brother, don't be stubborn. When you want God to guide you, surrender, because that's the dying to yourself. And John G. Lake gonna say, in the daily experiences that God puts us through, it is designed to help us die.
Amen.
Let me read it quick. Then we go. It says here, in going into this question of the death life, my spirit recently has been drawn out to observe that in the Old Testament, there is a type and evidence of the real death life. In the 16th chapter of Leviticus, we have that wonderful picture of the atonement and life death of the Lord. Likewise, the atonement and life death of his people. In the presentation of the two goats, we read it, right? The two goats to represent the life death and physical cross death. You see, physical cross death. The life death and then the physical cross death. The death that he's going to die by his obedience. And then the death he's going to die on the cross. There are two of them. Right? He said, the one goat was to be slain. Its blood to be sprinkled on behalf of the people. Its body to be burned, consumed, and destroyed outside the camp. Now, the life death. The one goat, the one I especially want to call your attention to now, is the one that was taken on the tow rope, the Azazel, the one that removes sin. The tow rope by a Levite. 3 days into the barren sands. 3 days of walk with this guy, with this goat. Oh, lonely goat. You don't have nobody. All he has is the Levite dragging him down to the wilderness. The call of God dragged Jesus down to the wilderness. The call coming to save us. In his obedience. In his obedience, he has to go. He had to go to the wilderness. The devil had to tempt him. It says here, the barren sands of the wilderness, until worn and weary of exhaustion and starvation, it was left to die. This goat was left to die because he's tired in his obedience and going through what he was sent out there, he finally died. Right? That's the Azazel carrying the sins of the people that was laid, Aaron's hands was laid on the head of that goat. All right? He says here, until worn and weary of exhaustion and starvation, it was left to die. This was the other face of sacrifice. You hear that? That is the bearing away. Jesus, the bearer of our sins into the desert of this life. Not the, you see here, he says here, this was the other face of sacrifice, not the giving of its blood. There was no blood shed in this. There was no blood shed in the Azazel goat going to die. He died a natural death from the exhaustion and starvation and the obedience. The obedience that he was led to. He didn't say, I ain't going nowhere. He didn't sit down in the street. He just went. He just went. The tow rope represented the Levite, represented the Holy Ghost. And Jesus, full of and controlled by the Holy Ghost, was what? Amen. Was what? Amen. That is Azazel. He's going to the wilderness to be tempted and tried. And then he will live that kind of life of for 3 years. Absolute obedience. Not doing his will. I said, not the giving of its blood and the burning of its body. Nothing of this happened to the Azazel goat. They didn't shed blood. They didn't burn his body. But the working out of God in its own being and in the real life, it dies. In real life, he dies. And that's what happened to Jesus. In real life, as he's living daily. Living, what did Paul say? I die daily. And yet, was he dying daily? Yes, or dying daily, spiritual, dying to his own plan. Yes, God. Did he not cry three times, pray, Lord, save me from this thorn. Father God, save me from this thorn. Tell me, sir, son, my grace is sufficient for you. Therefore, I'm gonna glory in my infirmities, so that the power of Christ will dwell on me. For when I'm weak, then I know I'm strong. He's weak, but he's strong. How do you understand that? He's weak in his own strength. He gone. But when he cannot do no more, another strength is given to him. He said, yeah, Jesus on the tow rope. We come to the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, who presented himself at the River Jordan. Notice his life at the River Jordan, that all the righteousness of God might be fulfilled in him. And immediately following, we read that he was driven or led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. We see that after his baptism, he was under the control of the Spirit of God. That the Azazel goat in the hands of the Levite. You hear that? All right. Being under the control of the Spirit of God, just like the goat that was led by the Levites, so our Jesus, by the Holy Ghost, God's Levite, was led 3 days. 3 days, God's time, which is 3 years. The 3 years of his ministry was when he was led into the wilderness of this life, including the temptation in the desert. So his 3 years ministry That's what gave him the opportunity to exemplify or to fulfill the Azazel goat's mission. That of 3 days being dealt with. 3 days learning to obey, learning to yield, learning not to do his will. You all don't understand. I came here, he said. I came here not to do my will. My father loves me, but I got to obey him. I can't do my own thing. No, no, he that sent me, he's with me. But I got to do his will. Doing the will of God led him to die. Total surrender. And when Don Gillick will say, that is why it is written, because of that, he is able to save to the uttermost those who come to God by him. You see, then I told the Lord says, it is by my obedience that I saved. By my obedience. Because of that obedience, complete and total surrender to the will of God, he is established as a savior. Amina. Today, no Amina online. I never heard no Amina. One man, no Amina. Amina. Hey, where is Charlotte? You ain't Amina, daddy? Oh, brother Duane, you held their mouth. What's wrong with that? That's why they ain't saying no Amina. Because their mouths are held. Ooh. Yes, God. I've wondered, I've gone this far, I ain't gone no Amina. yes, God. Yeah, yeah. Freedom. Unloose them, my brother. We don't hear because they held your mouth. Brother Dwayne put some bits in your mouth so you can't talk. Oh, yes, God, Brother Dwayne. Oh, my Lord. You made me feel lonely. I had no accompaniment. All right, let's finish right and go. All right, it says here. Are you following this?
Yes.
This is very, very, you know, vital. It's another understanding of what Jesus said, because I haven't heard anybody shed light on the obedience, total obedience that led him to death, dying to his own will, dying to everything. That's why he couldn't do nothing on his own, because he's aware that he must die to his own. Oh, it was a great temptation. Yes, God. Says here, he was made. Okay, let me go back. All right, I've seen. Just like the goat that was led by the Levites, so our Jesus, by the Holy Ghost, that is God's Levite, was led 3 days, God's time, which is 3 years, a day for a year. A day for a year into the wilderness, just as the original goat had been led 3 days into the wilderness. My Lord, has been led until he died. Out, listen to this. Jesus, until he died, out to the claims of this threefold nature. Everything his spirit desired, he said no. Everything his soul and his thoughts and emotions wanted to spread, he said no. Everything his body desired, he said no. He died to the threefold demands of his personal being. He will not eat bread. He will not use power to make bread, no. He will not allow the devil, okay, to deceive him by showing him the glories of this earth, the glories of this of the nations. No, and he ain't gonna allow the devil to let him bow down to another god. So everything that Satan showed him, he said no. I wouldn't do that. I surrendered my body, spirit, soul, and body to my daddy. And I'm not going to use any part of it independently of my father. I wouldn't do that. My father didn't tell me this. My father didn't ask this of me. So I ain't going to do it. My Lord, my Lord. Obedience. The price of obedience. Obedience is what will kill you. What will lead you to die to the self life. It's not the cross that you're going to be. You know why Paul said, I have been crucified with Christ, and nonetheless I live, yet not I, yet but Christ that liveth in me. All right? You say, you know why? Because crucified in the real sense is on the cross, on the cross, on the tree. But in the spiritual sense, all right, he said no to every expression of his being. Just as Christ said no to every expression of his being. So Paul says, oh no, I said no. You know, what did he say? He said, listen, I buffet my body. I subject my body, all right, to the spirit. I ain't going to allow my body to go and do some stuff. We follow the desires of our bodies and we are entrapped. We follow the desires of our soul and we are entrapped. We desire some spiritual blessing and then we take the wrong way to look for it. We are entrapped. No discipline in our desires. And I know you are not saying amen. He says here, I like this. For 3 years, not by the death of the cross, but by a living death. No, let me go back. Let me go back to the one I said first. He said, which is 3 years, a day for a year. He was led into the wilderness, just as the original goat had been led, until Jesus, he died out to the claims of his threefold nature. The claims of his spirit, the claims of his soul, the claims of his body. He died to all of them. He will not allow them to be expressed unless the Father's will was met. Yeah, we can do anything we want with our body. But brother, you see, your obedience is pathetic. Our obedience is pathetic. Because we still exert our will, oh yeah, over God. Oh yeah. Who, boy, you ain't easy to die to your will's desires. In the big things, in the big things we seek God. We seek God's counsel. But in the small things we go on our own. Because God, this one is too small for God to handle. I can handle that. And that's where we fall. I can handle that is what brings it down. The Lord told us, he said, listen, every little thing, bring it to me. Because you don't know. You don't know what I know. I see everything and its implications. I see down the line. You don't even see today what will happen at the end of the day. So everything, seek counsel from the Lord. The Lord, if it is his will that is good for you, who will let you not walk in that realm? Okay, the Lord says another word. He said, D-O-U-R, a dower God. D-O-U-R. I'm not a dower God. Neither a God who hates pleasure. I'm not a God who don't want my children, having pleasure. I give you pleasure from myself. That's right. I'm not a dower God. D-O-U-R. I'm not a God who hates pleasure. And don't want my children to have pleasure. I give them pleasure, but pleasure that are clean pleasures. Amen. At the right hand of pleasure forevermore. Woo! Yes, God. But you want a pleasure in Detroit, not at the right hand of God. You want the pleasure that come from Detroit, come from America. Woo! Yes, God. Boy, you say you are tough, but I'm tougher. I find everything, every answer for you. Thank God. He says here, for 3 years, not by the death of the cross, but by a living death, the yielding of himself moment by moment. There you go. It is not by blood. You know, the 3 years, he didn't shed no blood. Did you see a blood in a shed in the 3 years? No. And yet he was dying. He was dying by learning to yield his body, to yield his soul, to yield his spirit to Daddy God moment by moment. So for 3 years, not by the death of the cross, but by a living death, the yielding of himself moment by moment, hour by hour, day by day, unto his Father's will. Can you live this life? And yet this is our life. Death life, death life. He's dying, he's living, he's dying. You find that the more you die to the flesh, the more you die to the natural, the more you accumulate the spirit forces. Y'all don't say nothing. What happened to your tongues? Why don't you talk tongues? When you get happy, Lord, give us some shout in some tongues, brother. Amen. But you don't understand that we talk tongues, we get happy. Huh? We talk tongues, we get happy. Me and Pastor Fields, we get happy. You talking, I'm talking. I mean, oh yeah, now you are untied. Ooh, for 3 years, listen to that. Not by the death of the cross, but by a living death. The yielding, you go and read 2 Corinthians chapter 4. You find that we participate in his death, not the cross death, but his death to the self life. You see in there. Okay? As we die to the self, all right, dying in obedience, so we live. In abundance. Thank you, Jesus. This is what, you know, Paul was trying to, you know, shed light on 2 Corinthians chapter 4. We partake of his death so that we partake of his life too. Right. Amen. Says here, you see, and it's the same thing that we see in Romans chapter 6. Because as you are buried under the water, right? You are taking part of his death. And then you rise from the water. You partake of his resurrection life. Amen. Death life, death life, death life. So for 3 years, not by the death of the cross, but by a living death, the yielding of himself moment by moment, hour by hour, day by day, unto his Father's will. He demonstrated to God and man that he was an overcomer and was the one man who had triumphed over sin and over self. What does the book say? What does the song say? Do you have victory over sin and over self? Is that high right with God? Amen. So Jesus had victory over sin. Temptation couldn't get him into sin. Victory over sin and victory over the self life. He will not yield the self-life or lie to sin. No. Let's go on. He said, the result of this kind of life. Thus, in this way, Jesus became the author of eternal salvation. Why? But I told you, the Lord said that it was by his obedience that he saved. So that is how the salvation will come to us, through his obedience. So he became the only one who obeyed perfectly. He became the author of eternal salvation, yes, unto them who come to God by him. Yes, thus he became the author of eternal salvation. And so our Christ, our Lord, could come. And so from this realm of total obedience, from this realm, he could now walk. After 3 years, he could now walk. Yes, gigantic in our steps. Jesus, are you ready? Daddy, I'm ready. I'm ready. You ready to go on the cross? Yes, Daddy. Luke chapter 10 or so, verse 51. when he says, and when the time come for him to go to the cross, to go to Jerusalem, right, and that he should go to Jerusalem, he set his face, set his face as a flint to go. He's ready. He want to go. Why? He conquered the self-life. He conquered. He was triumphant over the self-life, over sin. Now he going. Now he going now to surrender to the death of the cross. After he has died, Lord, to the self-life, to his will, now he can go and become the sacrifice. So he's saying the result of the death life, you know, for 3 years, 3.5 years, that he became the author of eternal salvation. And so our Christ, our Lord, could come and present himself at the cross as the second goat. Hallelujah. The second goat for destruction of the body, that his physical life might be poured out and that his blood might be shed for the salvation of men. You see that? You see exactly the two deaths? The two deaths, the one that you got to understand that. And you are to, the way Christ as he is, so are we. The way that he went is what we have not been taught. We want to. Who is going to go and die on the cross? Who? No, that's for him. But this one, this death to the self-life is for you and me. It's for you and me. Now, after you have obeyed the Lord in total obedience, if it pleases the Lord to have your life sacrificed unto him, then you die. If he calls you, that death will be the only way to please him. You surrender to it because you're already dead to the self-life. So it is just a matter of total surrender to the Lord. If that's what the Lord said, listen, my people don't stand in for me when death comes. They don't stand in. And yet I stood in. See, now it makes sense when he said I stood in. Because why? Because he died to self. He died to the self-life. It was easier for him now to look and say, okay, whatever comes, let it come. If it has to be the cross, let it be the cross. But if you ain't died to self, brother, when they point the gun on you, hey, deny Jesus or we shoot you. You're going to deny him. Because you ain't died to the self-life. You ain't died to the will. You ain't die. You don't care nothing about life. You know that Jesus Christ is all you need. So if death comes, I'm going to see Jesus.
Amen.
It says here, all right, then it says there's a need for teaching. Beloved, let me tell you, there has been a superficiality in our dealings with men. We say, brother, come and kneel at the altar and die. Don't you say that? Well, yeah, we say that the old timers. Hey, die, die. The guy ain't dying. And we say, come and bow and kneel at the altar and die. And yield yourself on the cross and etc. And the individual comes and he finds that when he goes away, the operation of death has not taken place in him as he had desired it. Because how do you have death? Because this death, it takes a consistency in obedience. To achieve the first death of surrender your will to God. All right. Let me finish. He says, like tempting the body. Then just as the goat who yielded himself to the control of the Levite and was taken on the tow rope 3 days into the wilderness to die, so Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Mind you, he was led by the Spirit. He did not get there by accident. It was in the purpose of God that he should be tested and tried in order to demonstrate that his consecration was genuine and in God. Consecration that we did at our baptism. Is it real?
Amen.
When you are tested, will you stand the test? When your body, the devil, you know, place some desires on your body, will you yield? When the devil gives you some lustful desires in your soul, will you bow? And the devil puts some unclean things for you to go and do and dishonor God, will you bow? And yet you have surrendered your body at your baptism, triune baptism, unto God, into God, into Christ, and into the Holy Ghost. So think about your consecration. It says here, mind you, he was led by the Spirit. He did not get there by accident. It was in the purpose of God that he should be tested and tried in order to demonstrate that his consecration was genuine and it was in God. The temptation begins. First, Satan presents to him a temptation peculiar to the demands of the body alone. He had fasted 40 days and 40 nights and was unhungered. That's what God says. He was hungry. Okay. Satan says, command that these stones be made bread. But Jesus, our Lord, remembered that at the Jordan, he had committed his body and all its claims unto God and rejected the temptation and put it from him by the word of God. God's glory, listen to this, God's glory and man's salvation were more to him than the hunger calls of his body. Bless God. The same thing happened when they were hungry at the Samaritan woman's meeting with Jesus at the well. All right, they are talking, and Peter said, Jesus, we're hungry. We ain't got no food. Can you send us to go buy? Yeah. All right, what you gonna buy? Yeah, we're gonna look for Jerusalem chicken. Oh, your Samarian, bulldog. Okay, so they go. Oh, yeah, hot dog. Yeah. Peter and James and all that, they all go and leave Jesus alone. But when you say, Amina. But when we go with them, yes, God, let's go, brother. I know where it is. I know where the Jerusalem. Hey, I was in Ghana. I was in Ghana some years back. And just beside the church where I was going, there is this store over there, say Jerusalem goat. It's written down there, they sell Jerusalem. I said, wow! Jerusalem goat. She says here, Jesus, no, so when Peter them came back, oh boy, they got a good hot soup with Jerusalem goat, Samarian and a sheep. And all the brother, it was good, hot, warm, everything was steaming good. And Peter, they come back. Now, what is he doing there? I said, Jesus, we got the goat. And now you're talking. Leave her alone and come, let's eat. We are hungry. Now, he ain't coming. He likes talking too much. Jesus, Peter, what's wrong? All right, listen. Guys, you all go and eat. What do you mean I go and eat? Didn't you send us to go and buy the Jerusalem goat? Yeah, I sent you. But I got meat to eat. I got meat to eat that you know nothing about. Come on, Jesus. This woman brought you some meat. Oh, no, we don't believe she brought you some. Did you arrange with her? Then you sent us away. So I got meat to eat. My meat is to do the will. To do the will of my Father who sent me and to finish his work. That is what sustains me. You all go and eat the barbecue dinners and be sustained by that. But I'm sustained by the will of my Father. That satisfies me. But you don't understand something. Listen, you don't understand. For many, many years, I've learned that. When I go into the nations, when I go, okay? I make up my mind. I ain't gonna eat nothing the whole day, okay, until I finish my Father's work. Until I've gone and preached and finished. And in the night time, I find me some Jerusalem goat. You see, this is the discipline. Because I learned in America, when you go to some churches, the first thing the pastor will call you, can we go and get a bite? You know, let's go and get a bite. I say, Pastor, no. He said, oh, come on, man, let's go and get a bite. No, let's go and grab a bite. I said, no, I ain't going. And I stayed the whole day, and they're surprised. Hey, boy, what's wrong with you? So you don't eat all day, brother. I'm a mission. I'm on a mission to finish my father's work.
Amen.
When I finish it, I'll eat.
Come on.
Are you hearing me? You learn discipline in the field to get impact. Ooh, yes, God. If you follow food, you become a fool. You follow food, you become a fool. God didn't say, I mean, the only one. Hey, where is God's doulos? No, Amina, God's doulos. Oh, more, I'm sad. Okay, let's go on. So he says here, God's glory and man's salvation were more to him than the hunger cause of his body. All right, there he said, tempting the soul. We finish it. Once again, Satan, seeing that the temptation had failed, makes a claim to the higher realm of his nature. He begins with his body, the lust of the, or the flesh, okay, and the lust of the eyes. Okay, now next one, that's his mind and his emotions. To a higher realm of his nature, his mind or soul. He takes him to a pinnacle of the temple and says, cast thyself down before these unbelieving Jews, so that they, seeing you are able to cast yourself from such a height, they will recognize you as their prince and crown you as a king. It's all right. Jesus says, all right, do not be afraid. Just do it, because he will give his angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways, bro, Jesus. But our Jesus, remembering that he had committed his self-life, the soul life is the self-life. He committed his self-life, his soul, his mind unto God, rejected the temptation. The tempter is turned aside. No crossless crowning for the Lord. Oh, no. No bloodless glory for the Lord. He had committed himself to God. God had given him as a ransom for many. He, the Father, gave his only begotten Son. So there was no way for our Lord to go back, to go the way the Father had mapped out for him. Jesus knew no will of his own, only the Father's will. Blessed be God. How abundantly this is demonstrated in the Garden of Gethsemane, when the great climax of the great earth life, the great testing, came in the garden. All right, all the death life had arrived. Jesus went into the garden when the sorrows of mankind, the consciousness of sin, came upon him with such abundant power that from his person there began to flow great drops of blood, falling down onto the ground. Reason, science, everything demonstrates that when such a thing becomes possible, death is near the corner. Right, then he said, Jesus, Lord, come to the last here. So reason and everything in the middle demonstrate that when such a thing is in any measure becomes possible in a human life, that death is apparent. In the case of our Lord, it was not a little drop or two, but great drops of blood ooze from his person. So that the Lord himself, understanding and knowing and being convinced that even his life was passing out, prayed that wonderful prayer in the garden, Lord, if it be possible, let this cup pass away from me. Jesus was not a coward. He was not praying for fear of the cross. No. Instead, he was a hero. He was praying in an agony of fear that he would not reach the cross. That's why he said, if it be your will, let this cup pass away. Because they had agreed that he would die on the cross in Jerusalem, not in the garden. Now death is coming. Now he's facing the real pressure. So much so that he was losing blood. And he believed that he was about to go. And he said, no. Oh, no, it can't be. I ain't going to die here. Father, let this cup pass, if it is possible. Yet not my will, but your will. Then they sent angels to come and minister to him. Angels come and minister to him and strengthen him so he could go on to Jerusalem.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He said Jesus was not a coward. He was praying for the fear of the cross. He was not praying for the fear of the cross. Instead, he was a hero. He was praying in an agony of fear that he would not reach the cross. God had designed that his end should be what his end should be. And he, by the consent of his own nature, for you and me, had likewise designed that there could only be one end. And that was that he should die on the cross. His prayer was heard. Angels came and ministered to him and strengthened him. And then with joy and gladness, our Lord went on to the cross and poured out his life's blood. Okay? He says here, so we see the temptation to cast himself from the pinnacle of the temple, being an exhibition of his power, and thereby getting the acclaim of mankind, was not God's way, nor God's will. He had committed his being, his mind, his soul to God. He could not go that way, and he did not. He wouldn't die in the garden. He has to die in Jerusalem.
Amen.
Now, the last one is tempting the spirit. Okay? Now, temptation of the spirit is to serve the devil. Right? The devil wanted him to bow to him, and Jesus will not. Because he remembers he has made the consecration of his spirit triune being to the Father God. And there is no way he's going to serve another God. Right? Remember. After that, he says here, therefore our Christ, having committed his spirit unto God, rejected the temptation of the devil and started from that hour to demonstrate by his daily life and his daily living that he was dead to all the claims of his nature. Thus, in this way, he could say, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Nothing natural coming through from me. Nothing natural coming through me now. When you and me want to go and exercise power, but we are all full of flesh, full of self-life, full of our own desires. How can we express the power of God? You see that? He said, the words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. Do we speak the same or we just speak our own mind? You see that? So dying to self is very important. You got to die to your will. You get the power of God and go and do what you want. The power of God must be exercised to do the will of God. Right? He said, there was one life surrendered unto God, the only life in all the race of man that was able to present itself unto God, obedient even unto death, dead to every part of his nature, his spirit, his soul, his body. Blessed be the name of Jesus Christ. Beloved, God has designed for you and me the same blessed, wonderful triune consecration, typified in the triune baptism into the nature of the Father and into the nature of the Son and into the nature of the Holy Ghost. Triune, everything that Jesus, all right, had to go through for the 3 years ministry, it was possible because he had consecrated himself at his baptism. At his baptism, he surrendered his spirit, his soul, and his body completely to the Father God. Right, so I will not, those of you who have, you know, who have the John G. Lakes in the book, you can continue to read and enrich your own soul. But I believe by the Spirit of God, I have shed some light, okay, on this, especially this death life. This death life, you must die to everything natural in you. Everything that nature must go, the self life must go. You must die to it. Right, your sins have been nailed to the cross, right? But the self-life must be rejected. You must die to your self-life, right? So that Christ can have a free expression through you to do the work of God. May the Lord our God bless each one of you. May this day be written down in heaven that something happened this day, especially in the triune baptism and the explanation of the baptism that the Lord has given to us. And we thank God for our brother John G. Lake and the fact that this guy blazed the trail in understanding the scriptures. May God help all of us now that we have understood it. Keep the truth. Keep the truth and don't sell the truth. Don't compromise no more. If the Lord will use any of you to go and do his work, remember the triune God wants triune baptism. Right? And the triune God, okay, is the one who saved us. The Father has a role to this. Can you imagine reading the word of God? God was in Christ, reconciling all the sinners back to himself. God was in Christ. Yes, it was Christ who died, but God was in Christ, reconciling. The triune, the Holy Ghost was with Christ. Was it ever written that when the Holy Ghost as a dove came upon Jesus, that the dove fled? Was it said that Jesus his nature was incompatible with the dove's nature? No, the dove was the most timid bird. It doesn't take much to scare the dove to get the Holy Ghost to flee. It's not said don't grieve the Holy Ghost. But Jesus never written anywhere that Jesus grieved the Holy Ghost. Never said anywhere that the Holy Ghost said, Jesus, no, I don't like it. Your behavior is not right. Me, I'm Holy Ghost. You are a human being now. I don't like it. You have to be obedient. Never. Jesus knew the nature of the Holy Spirit. Now, can you see a picture more wonderful than the Lamb of God, you know, and the dove in their communion? The Lamb of God, no other animal was so humble than the Lamb. And no other bird was so wonderful than the dove, pure and humble. Simple, obedient, and humble. One is pure and humble, one is obedient and humble. Can they not get together? Oh yes, God. That's a combination that God. We must be obedient and humble. The Holy Ghost is already pure and humble. The Holy Ghost as the bird is pure and humble. He's waiting for someone who is obedient and humble. So that you can commune with the Holy Ghost. Father God, we thank you for what you have wrought in our hearts today. I ask, oh God, that you bless your church, bless your people. Every single one who is part of the brethren in Michigan. Father, may their walk with you be highly lifted up. Lord God, Lord, sustain them. Lord, lift their hearts up and focus their attention on Jesus Christ. Father God, grant them that obedience, that which a man, when he possesses it, will let a man obey God in every area, every arena of their life. I pray for every single person that is part of the brethren of honor in Michigan, that Father God, you will use them. You will, Lord, prepare them for what is coming. I thank you, God, for the blessings, Lord, rich blessings that you bestowed upon us. I pray for this understanding, that your people will understand the scripture. Open their mind that they will understand the scriptures. I pray that it will be so in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, I thank you for giving your peace to your people, the peace of the Father, the peace of the Son of God, and the peace of the Holy Ghost. I'll be released into your lives. Love, joy, peace be your inheritance in Jesus' name. And everybody said, Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a clap of. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Woo! Yes, God, Pastor Phil.